Thank you very much. I'll just explain that. His friend Steve, who I know from JOLT. Anybody here work in Japan? You know the JOLT organization, right? So JOLT is the Japan Association of Language Teaching, not teachers. I don't know why the, what the distinction is. And I've done many presentations at JOLT for a mainly English language teaching audience, ELT audience. Okay, but so I'll explain more about that later, but not the title of my talk is Motivating the Unmotivated, 10 Ways to Get Your Students to Do Something. So number one, my background is ELT. Number two, my talk is about classrooms and doing things in classrooms. If you're okay with a bit of practical stuff, is that all right? Yeah, okay, you've had a lot of theory stuff today, excellent stuff. I'm delighted to sit and listen to people's research. This is kind of my research as well. Okay, but before I start, I have to say the most important thing really about teaching is feeling a sense of success. Here's a very important quote from a very important academic, Bill Cosby, the actor and comedian. This is really important. In order to succeed, your desire for success must be greater than your fear of failure. This is very true of teaching, because often, without realizing it, we say, I'm not going to try that. You go to a conference, you see some ideas, you think, I'm not going to try that with my class. You think, my class, great idea, but not my class. And this is your fear of failure obstructing your opportunity for success. So all I would like to say is that whatever you see at a conference like this, you think you could use in the classroom, you should try it 3 times, okay? But I'm going to help you. I'm going to help you understand success via this place, okay? What happens at this place?
Tennis.
Excellent. Thank you for that quick answer, okay? Tennis happens. It's just finished. I want you to imagine that you are playing at Wimbledon, okay? Can you all please stand up just for a moment? I want you to stand up again. Just this once. Stand up. Thank you. Good. Now I want you to imagine you are playing at Wimbledon in one of those games where there's one person on this side and one person on that side. What kind of tournament is that?
Singles,
thank you. And it's the last game in the singles tournament, so it's the
final.
So it's the what final?
Wimbledon final.
The Wimbledon. How about singles final? That's what I'm looking for, yes. The singles final, and it's the last point of the singles final, the one when you can win. What is that point called?
Match point.
It's called match point in every game apart from the final. In the final, thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. You're marvelous. You're my tennis expert from now on. It's the final. It's championship point. And you are in the championship final, the final of the singles, and it's championship point. And you are going to win this tournament. Start thinking now about success, because here, singles final, second point. Here, if you're a woman, is your opponent, okay? She is your, do not worry, you can win this game. Just look at her in the eye, look at her in the eye, and you know you can win, all right? Don't worry, you will win. If you're a man, this charming young man is sovereign, okay? What are their names, please? It's not Venus, it's her sister. Serena. Serena who? Thank you, and? Okay, they are the people that you are about to serve for the match, okay? To serve, you need a ball. Can you get the ball in your hand, please? Let me get a ball in your hand and bounce it on the floor. It's not basketball, okay? That's basketball. You have to catch it again. Catch. Drop, catch. You're going to drop the ball like that. Catch it. Let me see you catch it. This is the difficult part. Catch the ball, all right? You're going to serve for the final. Are you ready? After three, get the racket. That means you might have to change hands with the ball.
That's my note.
Right. You've got the ball. You've got the racket. After three, are you ready? One, two, three, serve! I'm sorry, that was pathetic. That was absolutely pathetic. If you want to win Wimbledon, particularly if you are a woman, you have to make a very loud noise when you serve. This noise in English is called a grunt. A grunt. Can you please, after three, practice your grunt? One, two, three. That's terrific. That's great. You've got the grunt. You've got the grunt. Back to the ball. Are you ready? Okay. After three. One, two, three. Serve! I'm afraid that hit the net. I hit the net. Don't worry, you have a second serve. Here we go. You can win. Just think, you can win. One, two, three, serve!
You win.
Yes!
Congratulations. We are global champions.
Well done.
Okay, take a seat. But the serious part of that, think about how to create in yourself a feeling of success before something happens. Success comes in lots of different forms. Success is passing an examination, obviously. Success is cooking something that people want to eat. That's also success. But success is a state of mind. It's a state of mind, and it's a state of mind you need when you go into the classroom, if you're going to try something new, okay? So, before we go any further, I really need to know a little bit about you. So, hands up, I'm not going to ask you anything, but just so make sure everyone puts hands up. Hands up if you're a native speaker of English. Okay, hands down, hands up if you're British. Ooh, good, not very many Brits, excellent. Hands up if you're not British, but a native speaker. Okay, right, you're from Canada, I know that. Where are you from?
Australia.
Australia, and where are you from?
Ireland.
Ireland, okay, excellent. Now, hands up if you're a non-native speaker of English, not a native speaker of English. Okay, cool. Put your hands down. Now, anybody, native or non-native, put your hands up if at any time you teach in a classroom. Right, because sometimes at these conferences, people are doing a lot of research. That's excellent. Now, hands up again, finally, if you teach a language, English or another language, if you're actually involved in language teaching. Okay, a lot of you are not involved in language teaching. What I'm going to talk about is really about teaching languages, but I hope that some of it will have some relevance in other areas of your work. Because what I'm interested in is classrooms. Now, I saw a very interesting thing this morning talking about, I've forgotten the guy's name, about how little students learn when they're in the classroom, how much time they spend studying on their own outside the classroom. But we still have classrooms, and we still have to make the classroom experience a memorable one for the students. So, who am I? Better tell you who I am. Well, I'm based in London. I worked as an English teacher in Spain and the UK, and now I spend my time writing materials for English language learners. I've written 30 different titles. That's a total of about, well, I have about 70 books have my name on the front, but some of them have other people's names too. But including 12 series of what we now call course books, textbooks. I used to be the artistic director of something called the English Teaching Theatre, and I work in a shed at the end of my garden. That's the most important part, and just in case you don't believe me, that's my shed, and I really recommend, if you have a garden, build a shed. Get away from everything, okay? And especially a shed which does not have internet access, when you really have to really work. Okay, going back to this, the most important things in here for me are the fact that while I was writing these course books, I've written course books for China, for Latin America, for the Middle East, mainly for Eastern Europe, and then more general ones that have been used many different places, I was able to sit and watch other people teach and pick up on what their students liked about their teaching, which often the teachers didn't understand themselves. Interesting, when you talk to them afterwards, they loved it when you did that, did they? I didn't really notice. It's interesting to sit and watch other people teaching and see what their students like about what they do, okay? And the other thing is, this English Teaching Theatre of mine, which was a show for learners of English all over the world, and we did the show in 55 different countries. We went to some very strange places as well, where they said, you're going to that part of Madrid? My God, it's really dangerous down there. And you find that what they call the most dangerous or the most difficult part of a city anywhere in Europe is where the audiences are best if you give the audience a chance to take part in your show. So I feel this is true of the classroom as well. However difficult you think your students are, if you give them a chance to participate, to engage, to have some kind of say in what happens in the classroom, then things go really, really well. So, okay, I'm talking about motivation, and the motivation I'm talking about is the motivation which brings your students back to your class. I'm not talking about what they call intrinsic motivation. What is it inside the student that makes them want to learn English? And extrinsic motivation is often their parents saying, you have to learn English, that kind of, you know, those are very... But the classroom motivation, and there's one person who knows more about this than anybody else, his name is Jolton Jernier. He's written this wonderful book, Motivational Strategies in the Language Classroom. I would recommend it even if you don't teach languages. The motivational material in here is amazing. And he's done the most wonderful research with many thousands of students. And he basically asked them one question: what is it about your class that you like? What is it about your class and your teacher that you like? And he came up with five key motivational factors. The first one I'm going to leave till the end. The second, the teacher has a good relationship with us. This is the result of thousands of students, I have to say mainly teenagers. He mainly talked to teenagers, and mainly teenagers working or studying in state schools, public schools as you say in North America. Schools that they don't pay for, in other words, okay? The main area of his research was with students in state schools. And what they like is a teacher to walk in and say, good morning, how are you, as if they mean it, okay? It's a little thing, but it's the second most important thing for students. Bear this in mind, these are very simple things. She encourages us to think for ourselves. Astonishingly, most students say, you know, we have a very nice teacher, but she never asks us what we think. She never asks us what we think. She never asks us to give our own examples in language school material. I'll come back to that a bit later on. This is a nice one. She enjoys our progress and success. Do you still give paper homework? Do you give homework on paper, or do you have homework on a learning management system? Who uses paper homework? Who gives out or takes in paper homework? Because it's, you know, not many people still do it. There's a difference between handing a homework back and saying, well, it's better than last time, and saying, it's better than last time. Just in the tone of your voice, if you have that down tone, well, it's better than last time, what have I done wrong? A lot of this is students looking at the teacher saying, what have I done wrong to get this reaction from you? And I'm not asking teachers to smile and be fun all the time, but if you think about the times that you walk in and say, good morning, it's you lot again, you know, that kind of attitude to teaching. Students don't like it, and quite rightly they don't like it, okay? You need to engage them in a different way. This is nice, when she creates a safe and supportive environment. A lot of students in this survey talked about the lighting in the room, and nobody likes studying with neon lights. No teenagers like studying when there are neon lights. So if you have neon lights in your classroom, shoot them and find something else. Get something else in charge. But what is the number one motivational factor from the student's point of view about the classroom? The teacher is enthusiastic. What a nightmare that you have to be enthusiastic all the time. Here's another researcher. You don't know her at all. I know her very well. It's my wife. Okay. My name is Dee Dee, and when she did her master's in applied linguistics, her thesis was about perceptions of students who have a native speaker teacher and a non-native speaker teacher, not in the classroom at the same time, but as part of the same course. And I found this quotation. I'd rather have an enthusiastic teacher who isn't a native speaker, even if her English isn't perfect, than a native speaker who isn't very enthusiastic. That was said by a 16-year-old in Romania. Now this girl, this Romanian girl, may be the only person in the world who believes that, but I doubt it. Enthusiasm is the key. In our business, a non-native speaker should feel very, very happy to know that her enthusiasm is more important than my ability as a native speaker. In whatever other subject you speak, your enthusiasm for your subject is way more important than how much you know about it. I know you should know a lot about your subject, but it doesn't matter. If you show enthusiasm for what you're doing, that's what your students want, okay? But it kind of also means that as a teacher, you've got to wake up everyone and go, yes, I'm a teacher, I'm so lucky, right? And frankly, we don't, do we? We don't do that. We don't do that. In fact, most mornings, I used to work in three different colleges, well, private language school and two state FE colleges in London. When I was a young teacher, I had two small children, I was working like crazy, like most people have to do more than one job. And every Monday morning I had eight contact hours in all three different colleges, which involved train journeys between the three. And I used to wake up feeling like that. I was so stressed out on a Monday morning. Actually, I prefer this version of myself. Okay? But the fact is, as teachers, you know, hopefully you get some kind of reward back from the students if they enjoy your classes. One of my best friends is a dentist, and we were talking about it. I said, it's so nice being a teacher. You walk into the classroom, if they like you, they go, hey, she's here. Dentist said, they don't do that with me. They don't do that. People do not come into the dentist saying, hi, dentist, how are you? You know, actually, I shouldn't be saying, I've got a dentist appointment on Monday. I keep forgetting. So, no, but trying to be serious here, the value in teaching is very rarely financial. We very rarely get great financial reward out of being a teacher, but you do get spiritual reward. If you know, you feel you've done something for somebody, and they show it back to you. So, what I'm looking at now is how to make the classroom experience really much more dynamic with the help of the students. I don't expect you to run in, use the kind of energy I'm using now. I'm talking to a lot of people. If I'm teaching, I don't do this. I want to be a lot quieter. I want you to do the work, you see? But I'm kind of making this amount of noise to generate some idea of what it's like to start a class and then get them motivated. So let's try and find 10 motivated strategies. If you don't mind, I'm going to ask you to do my class for the next 15 minutes, all right? I might ask you to do one or two things. Right, number one, make your students curious. By the way, if you want to download this talk, I'll show you how at the end, for absolutely for free, from my blog. This is a keynote, so it only works on a Mac. If you go to my blog, you can find it as a PDF as well. So you can have all these images, all these ideas. If you want to use the images in your own classroom, that's fine. I do not have copyright on most of them, so please don't charge people any money to watch you doing this, okay? Right, now, I'm going to show you a picture in a moment. Image is really important, whatever you're teaching. Image is strong. If you're teaching languages, very quickly your students understand why you're showing a picture, why you're showing a picture on the screen or a picture here. Is you're going to say, what is he doing? Or something like that. And the students get used to it. So there's a filter already. They're waiting for the question. Here's an image. Oh God, what's the question going to be? What has he just done? What's he going to do? What's he wearing? You can see in their faces, after a short time, they pick up on your style of teaching, whatever your subject, and they go, oh, here we go again, that kind of question. I'm not going to ask you a comprehension question about this picture. I want you to look at the image, decide what your first reaction to the picture is, and whatever your reaction is the right answer. Okay? Whatever your reaction is the right answer, and then turn to the person next to you and say in words what your reaction is to this picture. Your first reaction to this image. Come on, guys, talk to people around you. That's what I want to do. Okay, what's your thought? Painful, painful. I like that word. Painful, okay? Pain, pain. What's your thought?
Pain.
Everybody's thinking pain? Anybody not thinking pain? What an idiot. Great thought. Angry. You're angry or he's angry? Okay, this is an image from a book. I now have the technology in my classroom to separate image and text. Do you all have this option in your classrooms? Right? I mean, you know, what are we going to do with these screens? What are we going to do with these interactive whiteboards? The number one thing, if you're using any kind of book, is you can separate image and text, whatever your subject, okay? So this is actually a book, but I've separated the image from the text so you can think about it first, okay? So let's have a bit of information about this guy. His name is Michel Lotito. He was born in 1950 in Grenoble. Where is Grenoble, please? It's in France. His name is known as Monsieur Mange Tout. Anybody know what that means?
Everybody.
Eat everything. Well done. He can eat a bicycle in 6 days. What? Now, class, are you curious about this guy? We can do an exercise if you like. We can do something else. Or would you like to read more about this guy? You really are a difficult class. Would you like to find out more about Michel Lotito?
Yes.
Thank you very much. Well, I'm going to give you a pre-reading task first. Here are two questions. What do you think is the easiest part of a bicycle to eat? Or what's the most difficult? There is your vocabulary. And don't worry, children, I don't expect you to know the right answer, okay? I don't expect anybody in this class to have eaten a bicycle. I hope not. So talk to each other and don't worry about your answers. Don't worry about your answers. What do you think is the easiest? What's the most important? Okay, easiest.
Tires. She thinks the tires are the easiest. Yeah, the tires. Okay, tires. What do you think?
The seat.
The seat. I like that. Maybe cook it with mushrooms or something.
The seat, the tires, the easiest. Tires. Seat. Okay, what about the most difficult? Most difficult. The frame's the most difficult. What do you think? The frame. You don't have to agree with him. This happens in class. Yeah, frame. He said frame. That's okay. He said frame and you didn't say no. I never say no. That's the point. I'm not saying no to any of this, right? So you don't have to agree with the person next to you. Most difficult.
The frame.
You think the frame.
Me too.
You've been brainwashed, you guys. Okay, you're all saying the same answer. Let's have a read. Let's read about it. Michel Lotito has been eating metal and glass since 1959. What year was he born? How old was he when he started this stuff?
9 years
old! What were his parents thinking? Doctors have x-rayed his stomach but remain mystified. Does that mean they understand there's the problem or not? No, they don't. His diet has included 10 bicycles, a supermarket trolley, 7 TV sets, and a Cessna-like airplane, which he ate in Caracas and Venezuela. This is true story. I'm not making this up. He can eat a bicycle in 6 days. I start with a frame. He thinks a frame is the easiest. Okay. Blah, 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 blah. The hardest part is the tires. Would you believe it? Okay. And I guess he says it's like eating a kilo of feathers. I have the option. Do you know the word feathers? You don't? Well, there's some feathers for you. I love technology in the classroom. Just from this simple point of view. Okay? Simple technology in the classroom. Now, you won't always get a text like that. But if in any kind of book, you often see in language teaching books, before you read, pre-reading activities, look at the picture, what do you think the story is about? There's the picture, talk to each other. You're a fairly elementary class, just talk to, no, there's no surprises, no tricks. What is this story about? Talk to each other. Okay, a car accident. Any other thoughts about this accident? Just from the picture. Any other thoughts from the picture? Road safety. Okay, very good for my elementary class student. Okay, here are the first 5 lines of the story. When a 6-year-old boy from Virginia, USA missed the school bus, he wasn't happy. He always had breakfast at school and he didn't want to miss it. He's unusual and reckless. That's in blue because it's a difficult word. Solution to his problem. He talked to each other and try and imagine what his solution was. What do you think he did? He stole the car from his parents. That's a crazy idea. That is a crazy idea. Because I know her, she always tries stuff like this in my class. Now, you've been in my class for 5 or 6 weeks. You know that I'm okay about writing wrong answers, so I'm trying to kid you on now, because I'll give you the headline now. 6-year-old boy drives a mom's car to school. Well done, well done. Would you like to read the whole story, class?
Yes!
So, turn off the technology, open your books. They go, book? What's a book? Oh, this thing here. Ah, okay. I know it's a bit skinnery in that, isn't it? But you can get people interested in books by starting the class on the screen and then turning the screen off and opening the book. It's a very, very good way to blend the screen and the book. Okay. That is from one of my books called Smart Choice, which is an American English course published by Oxford University Press. End of advertising. Okay. So, what is the message? The message is about pre-reading, pre-activities. Where are you? Pre-activities, whatever your activity in class, whatever you're teaching, you need to engage students' curiosity in some way or another. There's lots and lots of ways of doing it. That was just one. But curiosity increases motivation. Remember, I'm here to talk about motivating the students to come back to class because they enjoy the environment of being learning with you. Number 2, challenge them. For the very last time, I'm going to ask you to stand up one more time. You should all stand up one more time. And can you get into teams of 5? Get into teams of five and give yourself a number, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Into teams of five and get a number. Give yourself a number. Give yourself a number as well, okay? Okay. Put your hand on number one. Come on, gang. One. Right, well, I want to make sure. Put your hand on number two. Put your hand up number five. Okay, listen carefully to the instructions. First of all, tell me, who is this man? And who is this man? What can you tell me about these two men? They were both assassinated. Excellent. Do you ever notice you do that sometimes? You know, because, well, this is a language teaching thing maybe, but because the sentence is good, you say excellent. Both were assassinated is not excellent. That's terrible. In my class, when I used to teach in Spain, in the south of Spain, and Spanish students and Andaluz students will never use the past tense unless you hit them with a stick. They really won't, okay? So every Monday morning, what do you do the weekend? But one Monday morning, Juan came in and he was not in class on Friday. And I said, Juan, where were you on Friday? He said, I go to my grandmother's funeral. I said, go? He said, I went to my grandmother's funeral. I said, very good. Oh, your grandmother died. I'm sorry. Yeah. Right, sorry. Okay, now listen carefully to the instructions. It's Friday afternoon. You guys are often a bit puddingy on a Friday afternoon. It is actually Friday afternoon, isn't it? But in your class, it's Friday afternoon. You know what Friday afternoon class is like. If you allow your students to sit down, they enjoy your class, and they drift up into Planet Teenager, which is a very nice place to be on a Friday afternoon. So to stop that, when you stand up, you're in teams now. This is what's going to happen. I'm going to show you 10 pieces of information about the lives and deaths of these two men. Maybe you know some of this stuff already, particularly the North Americans, you probably know. It will be in two sets of five. If you're number one, you read number one, and then the 6, 7, 9, 10, you read number... If you're number one in your group, you read number one and number eight. Thank you. Good, something good at maths there. All right, if you're number two, number four, nine, well done, not eight, right. So one and six, you get the idea. You're going to see them in two sets of five. You have 7 seconds to process this information. Only 7 seconds. Are you ready? Starting now. 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Complain. That wasn't enough time. You must. I'm not used to students like this. I want you to go, no, teacher, he's on evil. No, I want to see again. Sorry, that's it. Here's the second set of information. 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Okay?
Yeah.
Would you like to see it again?
No.
You want to see it again? You want some more time? No, that's the point. There are some kids in the class who go, I've got that. I've got a photographic memory. I've got all 10, in fact. Right, would you like to see them again?
Yeah.
All right, 5 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. And again, here we go. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Don't worry. You'll see it all later, but just tell the people in your group what you learned in the time you had. Thank you very much. Take a seat. Relax. It was wonderful to watch you. Thank you very much for doing that activity so well. First of all, really, you are a very, very nice class. Really, I like teaching you. You're a nice class. A bit big for a class, but you're a very nice class. But I love doing this because I love watching people watch all the information at the end. It's great. Oh, look at that. It's amazing. It's incredible. Oh, look at that number five. Nobody is listening. But everybody's talking about the text. Fascinating. Absolutely fascinating to watch your faces. 5 minutes ago, it was Friday afternoon, after lunch, you were feeling like puddings. And I did that simply because I knew you have to wake up. I have heard all the objections of this kind of teaching. The teachers next door don't like it. This is the main objection. The teachers next door, if you do anything noisy, they don't like it. Well, I'm sorry, it's about time they started doing something noisy. You know, I have friends who work in the theatre company devoted to teaching physics. You can do physics through theatre. You can do maths through role play. You can do all kinds of things to make every subject come alive, okay? And that's what you should do. Don't listen to the people who say you're making too much noise. Okay, now, because I'm running out of time, I'm going to push on from this one to number four. Teach unplugged. Now, I don't know if any of you have heard this expression before. It's a very much an English language teaching expression, but it's spreading to teaching other languages and indeed to teaching other subjects. I'm going to show you a picture of one of my best friends. Any of you know who this guy is? Probably not. Well done! Well done, you are now my New Zealand ELT guru expert as well. Right. And about 2001, Scott Thornbury, who's a New Zealander, lives in Barcelona, he wrote an article saying, using course books, using materials in class, is creating a barrier between you and your students and what they really want to learn. At the time, it was only considered to be a language thing, but now, as I say, it's spread to other subjects. Using materials in class can create a barrier between you and your students and what they want to learn. Okay? Scott's wonderful example of what he's talking about and how materials get in the way is he was in a classroom in Mexico City on a Monday morning, and the teacher walked and said, "Good morning, class!" And the class said,
"Morning.
Mexico City, please." Okay, come here. A little bit of Latin. "Good morning, class!"
"Good morning!"
That's great, over there somewhere. Perfect. Okay, any Mexicans here? No Mexicans? Entonces, now that's all in Mexico City. Beautiful country. Right, okay, so the teacher walks in and says, "Good morning, class!" Try again. Okay, just, "Did you have a nice weekend?"
"Yeah."
"Jorge, did you have a nice weekend?" Jorge said, "Yes, I had a very nice weekend." "Jorge, what did you do?" "I got married." "Really?" Open your books at page 26. You see the problem there? So Scott will always say, you can walk into a classroom with your bus ticket from that day and have a class that lasts 45 minutes based on your bus ticket. Well, he can, most people can't. So that's the thing. So somebody else had to come along. Another very good friend of mine, anybody know what his name is? His name is Luke Meddings. There are their names. Luke came in and tried to calm Scott's more ridiculous ideas down about teaching without using materials. And they wrote this book called Teaching Unplugged. Very clever idea. Writing a book about not using books. And this is now usually referred to as dogma ELT. Dogma ELT. Why is it called dogma ELT? Well, does anybody know what dogma originally was? Anybody know what dogma was? Anybody recognize this guy? That is Lars von Trier, and he's a Danish filmmaker. And with his friends in the 1990s, he said, We must stop making these artificial films. We're too influenced by Hollywood. Too much action, too many explosions, too much cutting of scenes, too much time elapses during the film, too much makeup, you know. So they started making films. No makeup, no script, nothing, and in real time. And they said, only use things that are around the place. So this bag will be in the film because, you know, only use things around. And the most famous film in the dogma tradition is this one, Festen. Directed by Thomas Vinterberg. I have seen the film, so you don't have to see it. I will never get those 2 hours of my life back again. It is the most boring film ever made by a long way. It's more interesting watching paint dry. It really is, honestly. But this is nothing against Dogma ELT, because Dogma ELT is actually a much stronger movement than dogma filmmaking. And it basically consists of three things, again, which I think have a something to be said for every kind of teaching. It's materials light, it's conversation driven, and it deals with emergent language. And it's not just about teaching languages, teaching any subject. Find out what the students know, move on from there in any direction they want to go, fill in the gaps in their knowledge. Now, as a course book writer, I should never tell anybody about dogma, because dogma is spreading like wildfire through the English language teaching business, and not just amongst native speakers. Non-native speaker teachers all around the world are throwing away their course books and using simple materials, starting with a conversation, not just what did you do yesterday, but conversations about ideas, conversations about art, literature. And I thought, well, there are so many reasons not to use a dogma approach. You can't do it with beginners, you can't do it with examination classes, and most teachers in the world, thankfully, otherwise I'd be a poor person standing in the street, actually still buy books. However, last year, I became a student again. I went back to school to study this language. What language is that? Ja, ich muss ein bisschen Deutsch lernen, weil ich muss now. Perhaps you don't speak enough German for me to tell you, so I'll show you why I had to go. Anybody know where this place is? Try, doesn't matter, try. I will never say no. Nuremberg, what a fantastic answer. It's not the right answer, but it's a very, very good answer. Let me see the point here. If I said no, he said, well, that's it, I'm not going to say anything else. Right? I won't say anything else. So try and find a way. That's a great answer. It's very near Nuremberg. Very near Nuremberg. It's Bamberg. A place called Bamberg. Very similar architecture. Why? Because I was going to the wedding of these two people. My Spanish nephew Enrique and his German wife, now she's his wife, Lagina, who was born in Kazakhstan. Okay? 2 years ago, Lagina is one of the nicest people you could ever meet. She's a social worker in Bamberg. 2 years ago, she has the most wonderful accent when she speaks English. She said, Ken, I want you to do something for me. And I said, Lagina, I will do anything for you that is legal for the uncle of your future husband to do. She said, I want you to make a speech at the wedding. I went, oh, okay. So in English and Spanish and German. I went, what? I said, ich kann nicht so gut Deutsch sprechen. Doch, du sprichst sehr gut Deutsch. And I thought, well, I do, you know, my Deutsch isn't bad. It's not as good as my Espanol, and none of it's as good as my English, but I will try. So I went back to school. I went to evening class and became a student like the majority of language students around the world, learning a language not in the country where that language is spoken, learning German in London. And this was my book, Willkommen. I thought it's perfect. It says, Ich liebe dich on the front, I love you. What could be better than to find good ideas for a wedding speech? When I told the teachers, warum lernst du Englisch, Ken? I said, ich muss eine Leder an einem Hochzeit machen. She went, you've got to make a speech at a wedding. And you come to me for help? No. Now this teacher, before I say anything else, was wonderful. Hardworking, nice attitude, lovely voice, lovely accent. But the first thing she did was tell us in English her course design. She said, on this course we're going to talk about past holidays, which is a disguised way of saying we're going to practice the past tense, right? The second one says, we're going to chat about health issues and illness. I looked around the class. I was almost the youngest student in that class. I thought, I can't wait to talk about health issues with that 85-year-old woman over there. Du hast was? Ach, entschuldigen Sie, ich weiß nicht, was sagt man auf Englisch, auf Deutsch, hemorrhoids. It was a nightmare. We're going to describe weather features. The weather unit in every language book is the most boring unit in the book and also the most inaccurate. They always say the weather will be taught using the future tense. It will rain tomorrow. Bollocks, they never use that in weather forecasts. Okay, that's not too bad. Write a CV, that's a bit too late for me. And talk about German-speaking countries. And she never, never deviated from those. And she was a good teacher, but I kept trying to deviate. She kept, children, see, you know, stop trying to take us away somewhere else. I'm obviously the difficult student in this class, so I'm going to shut up. And that's what difficult students do. Difficult students are not necessarily difficult. They just have a different way of looking at things. And I know now, because I was the difficult student, and she never looked at me without going, like that. Okay, lovely girl. Okay, so what's the point of this? What is the message? Whatever your subject, abandon the plan sometimes. Follow the trail. Whatever subject you teach, somebody will say something. If you say, we haven't got time, we're going to do this in the book. That's such a cold water shower for whoever said that. Okay, give the students a chance to get involved. It's all about motivation, occasionally. Okay, right. Let them, this should be so obvious, again, not just in teaching languages. You know what? An awful lot of languages spoon-fed. I was watching this class in Spain as part of my research for a book I wrote for Spain. Often teachers don't like it when there's somebody like me in the classroom. Another story about that a little bit later, if I have time. But I went to this school, American woman there, she was so excited to have me come and visit her class, which was a very nice experience, okay? She said, oh, I'm so glad you're here. You will love my class. They love learning grammar. And thought, okay, well, I've never yet seen a class where you could say they loved learning, grammar. So I went in, I sat in the corner, she said, hi, everybody, and the class went, hi. I thought, uh-oh. She says, this is Ken, say, hi, Ken. They went, hi, Ken. I thought, they're all robots, it's weird, this is very weird. She said, today, boys and girls, they were 16 years old, private language school in Madrid. Today, we're going to do the second conditional. They went, yes! I have no idea what you're talking about, but you know, you're normally pretty interesting. Because she was, she taught grammar in an interesting way. So second conditional, and I'm not kidding, more or less exactly what you said. Second conditional is a hypothesis. If I had $1 million, I don't have $1 million, I'm a teacher, little joke, okay? If I had $1 million, I would buy, can't buy, don't have the money, I would buy a new house, I'd buy a new car, I'd travel around the world. I counted the examples she gave. She gave 19 examples. Then she said, okay, anybody got another example? The kid said, no, you have all the good ones. Okay, this is what it's all about. Whatever subject you're teaching, give them a bit of slack. Give them a chance to say what they think. And whenever I say this to language teachers, they say, but it's okay saying that. My students have great imagination in their own language. They have no imagination at all in English. Well, that's a bit unfair, but it's a question of how you present it. So, okay, well, how about telling a story? Here's a story called Doctors and Nurses. British people here, there's nothing rude about this story. Okay, at the hospital near where I live, all the doctors are women and all the nurses are men. When new patients arrive at the hospital, they always call the doctors nurses, which makes the doctors feel quite annoyed. Bit of sexism going on there, right? And they also call the nurses doctors, which makes the nurses feel quite pleased. Are you following the story so far? Right. One day at the hospital, a patient, a man, approached a doctor. Excuse me, nurse, said the patient, when can I see the doctor? Listen, said the doctor, woman of course, right? I'm a doctor. The man over there that you think is a doctor is actually a student nurse. Oh, sorry, said the patient. The last time I came to this hospital, that nurse said that you were a nurse. Well, I'm not, said the doctor. I'm a doctor, not a nurse. Well, once again, sorry about that, said the patient. By the way, what's your name? Nurse, said the doctor. Doctor, nurse. Well, there's the problem. Okay? Problem is, doctor's called nurse. Now, I decide, this is a very typical language materials text. It's all narrative and no description. All narrative and no description. So one day, when I was watching a class in Budapest, Hungary. Anybody here from Hungary? Hungary is an amazing country. They have more Nobel Prize winners per capita population than anybody else in the world. 22 Nobel Prize winners, either Hungarian or Hungarian-American. Amazingly bright people, very hard to teach. And they speak Hungarian in a wonderful way. They start very high and they finish very low. Also, when they speak English. And some of them kind of don't really seem to have many emotions. I was saying to one guy, have you had a good time with my theatre company? Because the guy took them around for 2 weeks. These have been the most exciting 2 weeks of my life. That's the kind of people you're teaching, okay? And so I had this class of 16-year-olds. And I said, now look. And they had the text, this text, in front of them. And I said, I'm going to ask you some questions about this text, but the answers are not on the page. So they all looked at the page, of course, you know. So the answers are not on the page. So you have to find the answers for me. Great suspicion if you do this for the first time with a class. I said, where is the hospital? And this boy said, near where I live. I said, near where you live? He said, near where you live. He says, not near where I live. He said, I don't know. I said, well, I don't know either. He said, if you don't know, how can I know? So I said, no, sorry. Look, it's your story. You know, but they're all going, suspicion, what answer does he want? Imagine the person who wrote it lives in an English-speaking country. Where's the hospital? Come on, you have this. It's your answer. Just anywhere in the English-speaking world. If you're a teacher and you can't do this, this is worrying, okay? Just a name of an English place, you know? We're in Brighton. Try Brighton. No, Brighton. That was somewhere else. Come on, it's all right. London. Nah, that's a bit boring. Vancouver. The most ethnically diverse city on the planet. I like it. The hospital is in Vancouver. How old is it? 20 what? Days? Months? do try and finish a sentence. 20 years old. So what year was it built? 20 years old.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
my mathematics?
Next question.
When was it built?
Oh, no.
20 years! 2014 minus 20. Come on, gang. Thank you. 19. Where are you from?
Originally.
Glasgow. You see, Scottish people know about maths. 1991. How many floors does it have?
Five.
Five floors. How many beds?
A thousand.
Blimey. 1,000 beds and five floors. Can you make a note? This is your homework to put all this on the story. 1,000 beds. Where is it? This hospital? Where is it?
Vancouver.
In Vancouver. Okay. How many doctors?
85.
85 doctors. That's clearly not in England, then, right? How many nurses?
135.
135. Is that the time or? You get the idea. And then you go through and you talk about at this point, the students go, I get it, right. Tell me about the patient. This is what actually happened with this Hungarian guy. I said, he's really old. Occasionally gives some ideas. This boy said, 30. No, he's really, really old. 32. Is he 16, right? If you're 16, 32 is really old. I'd like you all to double your age. Double your age. Is that old? Yes?
Yes.
In my case, it's dead for 50 years. Yes. You get the idea. So that's how it works. And suddenly the place erupts. All they have to do is give a number or a name, and they feel connected. Okay. And then you get to the patient, and you say, what's wrong with him? They're going, ah, I said, nothing horrible. Nothing horrible. We decide he's 84 years old. We haven't got a name for this patient. What's his name?
Gregor.
What's his second name?
Gregorovich,
I love it. I have to tell you, this is a terrible thing, but what happens in a situation like this, and you're probably aware of this, is that somebody goes, I get it, and they start answering all the questions. And everybody's very happy for this student to answer all the questions. So you've got to somehow find a way of saying, you're wonderful, but I didn't ask you all those questions, I'm not blaming you for this, but you know, you're wonderful, but please don't ask any questions. And so you find a way of saying, that's great, you've answered four questions, let's ask somebody else now, something like that. But I was doing this talk in Sharjah, in the United Arab Emirates, and I had all the women on one side and all the men on the other. And half of the women were wearing masks, you see, but one of them, a very pretty girl, had no mask on. And I was convinced, in this rather gloomy room, she was answering all the questions, so I had the same situation. Now, she's answered all these questions. She went, no, I haven't. I said, didn't you? And somebody from behind the mask said, it was me. Right, well, I'll go on to my next point. You see, once you've got students to do this, to sort of say, I can take part and I can't be wrong. It's wonderful, wonderful way of doing it. Right, I'm going to quickly pass on with that one as well because what's the time? Right, okay. There's a nice picture of the Queen, sorry. If you want to see that, you'll see it on. And I'll pass on with that now. Now, this is a bit straightforward. I mean, there's a lot of technology at this conference, and I just want to say one thing. First of all, I like this cartoon, I love it. I now pronounce you husband and wife and you update your Facebook status. You show this to some kids and go, hey, cool, I like that. Now, I'm going to ask about this simple question. How many students in your class have a smartphone?
Everyone.
Do you allow them to use their smartphone in class?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Sometimes, okay. This is a big issue at the moment. The fact of the matter is, however much technology you have at the front of the classroom, it is dwarfed in value by the technology in their pockets, right? So you've got a choice. And the choice these days is switch it off, keep it on, and some kind of contract. I have already had a class where I did this, okay? I said, I want you to keep your phones on because I'm going to ask you a question later on. And the problem is they start texting. So as soon as you find somebody texting or looking at Facebook, you say at the beginning, if anybody starts using social media during this class, then the contract is finished. The contract is over. I will not allow you to use this because you're not being fair. I'm trying to teach something. I think your phones can be useful. We can go to a dictionary app. We can go to Google. We can find some information. You can work on it together. But if you start doing Facebook, then the contract is over. So when the kids started using Facebook, so that's it. Phones off. Never again. And the place went wild. They were so angry. So the summer class I did last year in London. And I went back in the next day. And there was a delegation of the students saying, he wants to apologize for yesterday. Yeah. It's really interesting. Now that I'm making a joke, but it's really interesting to do this, okay? I said, okay, but this is really your last chance. I offered you the chance to help in the class, to be part of the class, and you didn't take that chance. I'm sorry, I won't do it again. And they didn't.
for the whole of the 2 weeks I took them. Nobody went, because they knew they were having such fun. I kept saying, okay, let's find this out from Google. Who's going to get it first? Right? And I got this idea with this man. Did we recognize him? He's quite famous. His name is Mark Prensky. He's the person who gave us the rather outdated division between digital natives and digital immigrants. He's the guy who made the speech saying that you're either a digital native, in other words, you're up to the age of 17, over the age of 17, which includes most teachers, are digital immigrants. So we have to learn about the world inhabited by our students if we teach teenagers, because they understand it better than we do. I think it's a bit unfair. I would consider myself, not, I'm obviously not a native, but I think my technology skills are pretty good. They're certainly better than my children's. My two daughters are so techno-derky, you know, hopeless, that I have to help them with their stuff. My grandson, on the other hand, who's six, shows me how to use my iPad. So this is the reality, okay? But I think it's really important to use the technology in their pockets. Technology you have at the front could be, you know, different in different circumstances. The technology in their pockets is almost certainly as good as it gets. Oops, I'm losing the back of this. So I'm going to be quick, I've got to finish. Now, my ninth thing, what is that? What is it?
Wheel.
Not a trick question, what is it?
Wheel.
It's a wheel, thank you. Now, you know what? Again, as I told you, I've watched about 200 classes in the last 20 years since I became a coursebook writer. I've watched 200 other teachers teaching. And there's been some wonderful teaching, but an awful lot of classes, to me, look like a wheel. Everybody in the room has a very strong relationship with the teacher, and not so much with each other, unless you say get into groups, right? But I think that relationship should be strong all the time. And here's an example of a wheel class. What's the capital of Argentina? Buenos Aires, correct. Now, I repeated his answer. Why did I repeat his answer? I'm aware of the fact that half of the class is looking at the back of his head, right? And therefore, but it actually doesn't help, because they never listen to him. They only listen to me. What is the capital of Thailand?
Bangkok.
Good. Did you hear what she said? And your class goes, they look at you and go, no, I didn't hear. Well, now, you're 14 years old. You've never done this before. Can you stand up? And just turn around and tell them what you just told me.
Bangkok.
Thank you very much. Take a seat. Now, that seems like a very small thing for her. But for a 14-year-old, that's quite important. And the 14-year-old goes home and says, I stood up and said something in front of the rest of the class. What did you say? Bangkok. Okay. Sounds like, but that's really a very special moment. And it changes the dynamic. People start listening to each other. So turn your class into a spider's web, or spider web if you're a North American. Okay? Make sure that at all times your students are connecting with each other. Almost finished. Okay, turn your class into a spider web. Number 10. Can you remember? I'm almost finished. Two more minutes, okay? Can you remember the number one motivational factor for the students as we found out by Jordan doing it? Yeah, you know, being enthusiastic is not a bad thing. Now, who is this wonderful woman? It is the recently deceased Maya Angelou. And I'm sure a lot of you already know this quotation. It's one of her most famous quotations. But I absolutely love it. I learned that people may forget what you said. They may forget what you did. But they will never forget how you made them feel. Why? Okay. And it's better. You know, it's not a good idea to walk in a class looking like that. Even if you wake up in the morning, your partner has a row with you, your dog is sick, your bicycle's broken, it's raining. It's not the student's fault. If you feel like that, just take a deep breath and walk in and smile. A smile costs nothing. It costs nothing and it changes the atmosphere in the classroom. Now you might think this is old-fashioned hippy-jippy stuff. I'm sorry, it works. Smile and things get back, you get stuff back. Scowl and they just look at you and say, what have I done wrong? And they've done nothing wrong. They have not done anything to deserve a scowl. So that's it. Those are my 10. I didn't do all of them. Okay? Those are my 10 ways to motivate your unmotivated students, to get them to do something. If you want to download this, as I say, you can go to my blog, which is kenwilsonelt.wordpress.com. You will see that again at the end, don't worry. That's what the first page looks like. Go to the right-hand column, and lo and behold, you find this thing called free downloads. Keynotes. You go to Keynotes. You can look at all the other I've written some plays, some short stories, some sketches, and have those as well. It's all free. Open Keynotes, and you'll find, aha! Brighton, okay? You open Brighton and you will see both my keynote as a Mac keynote and as a PDF, so all the images and the words are there if you don't have a Mac. And as a little bonus, I wrote a book called Drama and Improvisation. I've got 5 of my drama activities which I'm putting in there as well. So, that is my blog, that is my Facebook ID, please follow me on Facebook, and that's it. Thank you very much indeed for coming.